Hello everyone, and welcome to the first episode of Spider-Man Dissembled. This is Michael T. Bradley, kind of trying a roundtable approach to this, much like the main inspiration for this column, if you will, which was Life of Riley, done by Andrew Goletz, and kind of sort of as a co-writer, Greg Grunberg? Or is that the actor from Heroes? I don't know. In any case, their column was awesome about the Spider-Man clone saga. Really, really enjoyed it. And we're going to try to emulate that sort of idea here. The only thing we're lacking at this point is any sort of professional input, which would be awesome if somebody heard this and wanted to pitch in their two cents or even do an interview, which would be great. I would absolutely love that. So Life of Riley attempted to go through the entire clone saga and show what went right, what went wrong, what essentially brought about the clone saga and its length and why it did some of the things it did, the reasoning behind some of the choices, which seemed to have no reason at the time as a reader. We're going to be doing the same thing here, or at least a similar thing with similar goals, but we're going to be looking at Brand New Day and subsequent stories in Amazing Spider-Man, which is, at least at the time, as of Brand New Day, the only Spider-Man title there was. Now, if you listen to Civil War Acts of Treason, Jason's and my take on Civil War bit by bit by bit, you probably know some of this stuff already. I'll just go over it very briefly. The college I attended, because of its kind of counterculture nature and everything, one of the things that it did was start collecting Marvel Comics, which was, you know, at the time, new and revolutionary. And it kept a collection going. It kept a small portion of the funds it received going to keep a collection alive. And when I found out about the library there, I was able to go and spend many an evening reading and reading and reading, and that's how I discovered Spider-Man, really. I had been a comics fan for about 7 years before that, but I really wasn't into much Marvel. And this is, we're talking about 99-2000, I think. So I read Spider-Man and all the spin-offs from the beginning up until right about Todd McFarlane's time. I got really bored once McFarlane came on. I mean, his art was incredible, but, you know, you want to talk about Bendis having decompressed storytelling, McFarlane's was, oh my god. Anyway, not important. Point being, that's where I came into Spider-Man. I didn't really enjoy JMS's run that much, so I was kind of waiting on the sidelines for most of it. I kind of thought, well, I'll just hang out, and once it's done, maybe I'll read the collections, see what I think of it overall, but for the most part, I'll just ignore it. Well, of course, One More Day happened, and that became nigh impossible. We're not going to talk about One More Day at this point, and we're going to try to avoid it until Omit brings it into the equation, if you will. For right now, we're going to be focusing on the stories themselves.
Hi, I'm Jason Freston, and thank you very much, Michael, for inviting me to do yet another podcasty type thing with you. I've got a lot longer history with Spider-Man than Michael does, and mine dates back to 82. First thing that I remember seeing Spider-Man in was an issue of Peter Parker's Spectacular Spider-Man, where he fights the owl in, like, the Natural History Museum. I did a quick look to find the cover on it, because I recognized it instantly. The issue number 73, so yeah, it came out in 82, so yeah, I was 6. So I have been a Spider-Man fan for quite a long time. So, like Michael, when the One More Day thing happened, I was not very happy with it. I, for a number of reasons which we've gone into, I did not believe that that fit very well with Peter Parker's character. Unlike Michael, though, since I had such a long history with the character, I desperately want to like him a lot more, I think, than sometimes Michael does. Like, it was ruined forever for him. For me, it was just like, I would constantly post a One More Day, I dip my toes in and be like, well, you know, like they did something with Kane and Ben Reilly as a flashback type of a deal, and I'm like, maybe it will be good here, maybe I'll do this, and so I just dip my toes in and read that, and, you know, I wasn't too enthused about it. And then when Omit came out, which we will be discussing both of those story arcs, I'm sure, much more in depth as we get to that point, but when that came out again, I kind of dipped back into it. I'm like, maybe this will fix stuff, and this will make me love Peter Parker again, and like I said, we'll save that discussion for when we get there. So it just means that I tend to be a little bit more forgiving with, I don't know, forgiving is not the right word. I'm totally not more forgiving, but I'm more willing to accept. So I'm desperate to find anything to do with the character that reminds me of the old Peter that I can latch onto and just be like, I can ignore all the stuff I didn't like, because that's just how comics go. Sometimes they do stuff with people you know, you don't like, and you just have to soldier through. And so I was waiting for that point during the Brand New Day that I can be like, all right, that's fine. Everything else, water under the bridge. Let's just soldier through. Whether I have found that or not will be the part of the discussion that goes on as we do these things.
All right, so here are some of the things that I'm interested in. First of all, how do these stories interact with the continuity in previous Spider-Man? Do these characters feel like the same characters, or does anything feel radically different? Because obviously they wanted to start fresh here, so is there anything that leaps out as being so fresh it's jarring? Obviously a couple of really glaring things right from the beginning. We've got the organic web shooters are gone, which brings into question the veracity of the other storyline, the disassembled storyline, everything that led up to that. Harry being back, we have these questions. We'll tackle those more as we're doing reviews of the actual books themselves. I don't want to go into it too much at this point. Beyond that, how does the continuity within Brand New Day itself work? And that probably won't become an issue, at least for a while, I would hope, considering the Brain Trust is supposedly working together and making sure everything flows really well. But do they stumble within even the new continuity that they have proposed? And somewhat pertaining to that, but not necessarily as important, how does Spider-Man's new continuity interact with the rest of the Marvel Universe? That's going to be really difficult, especially for me, because we're talking like 3.5 years ago at this point, so since I haven't really read comics for like 3 years, a lot of it gets jumbled in my mind. I mean, it's like, they might mention the Skrulls, and I'm like, oh, okay, Secret Invasion has happened, so we're in Dark Reign now, but maybe it's just a passing joke, and then, you know, things don't match up. It's like Secret Invasion, Civil War, and the Dark Reign stuff basically kind of happened about the same time as far as I'm concerned. It's like there was Civil War, and then maybe a few months, and then Siege happened. That's kind of how it plays in my mind because I've been so divorced from it. No pun intended.
For the most part, from the stuff that I've read, I think we're going to discover that overall, most of the continuity within the Amazing Spider-Man title itself is going to be relatively solid, all things considering. Some of the continuity, though, outside of the title with the rest of the Marvel Universe is not going to match up quite as well. I'm not entirely sure, you know, why is that? I'm assuming, you know, it might just be lack of communication or misunderstandings or whatnot, but there's going to be a couple of issues that occur later on, specifically dealing with who knows about Peter Parker and the way he unmasks and what happens with that, that will contradict things that we see in different titles. But that's probably been a bit later on down the road when we will deal with that.
We're also going to be looking heavily at Tom Brevoort's somewhat manifesto, I guess would be the best word, at the end of the first trade paperback. Then, obviously, the last note that I have is just kind of general enjoyment. I mean, are these stories fun? Do we enjoy them? Do we get a kick out of them? I feel it's necessary for me to point out that during one of the final acts of treason, I basically said this is the final Spider-Man issue that I will ever pick up because they've ruined Peter Parker for me. They have, but it's been long enough now that I can kind of look back and view things with a bit more critical eye. I noticed that building up to One More Day, there are a lot of things that really showed how Straczynski and many of the other Marvel writers at that time, I can't remember who wrote the House of M Spider-Man miniseries, but definitely whoever wrote that. I want to say it was like somebody like Tom Payer or something, somebody really random. That could be the case. Jason will probably have to fact check that, so maybe he'll jump in.
House of M Spider-Man was written by Mark Waid, actually. I remember that specifically because Waid is one of my favorite comic writers, and I was bitterly disappointed by his take on that, because I totally think he just does not get Spider-Man, which is really sad, because as we get, well, I don't want to say he totally doesn't get Spider-Man, that's silly, but his take on it is just not one that I agree with for the most part, which is sad, because I think he actually writes some brilliant stories that happen to have Spider-Man in them, if that makes sense, and again, we're gonna, you know, get a little bit down the line when we start dealing with some of the Waid stuff, where that will happen.
Like, for instance, the House of M, I remember Jason and I had this discussion about it because Jason felt that it was really, really stupid for, like, where your biggest wishes came true that Spider-Man or Peter Parker would be with Gwen Stacy. It's like, that was years ago. He's gotten over. He and Mary Jane have such a history at this point that to say he would be with Gwen is really insulting. And I'm a huge Gwen fan, but even I agreed. And I think the only way to read it so that it makes sense is to say, well, it's his perfect world because he doesn't have to live with the guilt of having failed Gwen. It's not that they stayed together. I mean, I think a more realistic version of his, like, greatest dreams or whatever would have been Gwen's alive, buddies with MJ. Or they're all a happy threesome. I don't know, maybe. It's Peter. He hearts the ladies.
But yeah, I totally agree that Peter having a guilt fest and wanting Gwen alive and married to her is just total not right at all. Some kind of BS going on there, but, and a total misinterpretation of what Peter Parker's character is about, and a total insult to MJ also. I mean, it's like, totally House of M makes MJ just feel like, you know, the second best. Maybe even the third, you know? I mean, it's like, yeah, I just was not happy with the way that played out.
So with that and some other things, it's like, wow, they really were writing Spider-Man as if he was ruled by guilt, which I think is a brilliant way of misunderstanding the character for certain villains to believe. But for whatever reason, that seems to be what the actual writers believe. So it's like, okay, we'll just accept that for now, I guess, and then deal with the fallout as we go.
I don't know if this was intentional or not, but one of the side effects of making Amazing Spider-Man 3 times a month was that you just kind of get buried in these issues of post One More Day. And the farther you get from that, the more and more you kind of start to get disassociated from One More Day, the easier it is to forget that One More Day actually happened. Now, I don't really know if they had planned that, but it's kind of brilliant in its own insidious way. Because as I found myself reading through the current issues of Amazing Spider-Man, I would look back to see over how far I've read and over how much more I have to go along, and I'm like, wow, these are literally, it's like 3 years worth of issues in 1 year. So, which it's one of those things where on the face of it, you're like, well, duh, Jason. But if you really look at it, you're just kind of like, wow, that's fast and that's a lot of things. You kind of get to this point where you start to fade out and forget some of the One More Day stuff happened until they bring it back up. Well, until they kind of bring it back up, and then you're like, ah.
The way that I'm reading it, which might seem a lot of catapulting to go through to get to simply reading the books, is that I absolutely loved the Spider-Man Annual 2001, written by Howard Mackie. It was his final issue that he wrote before Straczynski took over the title back in 2001, obviously. Jenkins had been writing Spectacular or whatever it was, Peter Parker Spider-Man, I think, for a few issues at that point. The entire point of the issue is Peter and MJ breaking up because MJ can't handle what Peter's going through. The brilliant thing is that if you go from the end of that issue, skip to Brand New Day, and pretend there's a year or two you just don't know what happened in, it works really well. It works surprisingly well. There are a few things that don't make sense, Harry, for one, but they're not gonna make sense anyway. At that point, Spidey hadn't gotten the organic web shooters, he hadn't had the spider totem, blah, 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 blah. So it's like, well, in the meantime, Civil War happened, and we don't really know the details on that, but we're kind of being fed the details on what happened there in the Brand New Day stuff, because for people who had been reading Spider-Man that whole time, it was still a mystery, because it's like, why don't people remember that he's Peter Parker, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So the mystery still works. It's just for a different reason, but we're gonna get the answers as we read along, I hope. I haven't actually read it, but I've been told that we get the answers. So I'm coming at it from that angle, and that's the only way I was able to read this without wanting to punch Peter in the face repeatedly. If you, like me, were betrayed in a really personal way by One More Day, try reading it that way. I really, really suggest it. It works very well. I'm gonna go into more detail on that as well once we read Omit. Omit will really just open the floodgates for a ton of stuff. For right now, we're just gonna be looking at Brand New Day in and of itself, trying to understand how it works, why it works, if it works, what we like about it, what we dislike about it, and we will try to stay off of the One More Day stuff. All right, so I think that's it for me for right now. Hope you enjoy. Want to hear a lot of feedback, and absolutely, if anybody has interest in joining into the discussion, let me know. And, of course, as I said, it would be absolutely incredible and amazing if we could, in fact, rope in some professionals who actually worked on this to comment on it.
I'm totally looking forward to seeing where all this is going and hear other people's viewpoints. Hopefully, this format works for everybody. It will be interesting to do. But again, thanks for the creators of Life of Riley, because it is an awesome experience to read, and I highly recommend anyone remotely interested in the mostly underrated clone saga of Spider-Man, go ahead and take a read through that. It will give you a new appreciation of how the Clone Saga, what went on with the Clone Saga, and just kind of like sometimes how comics work in general, specifically in the 90s. So, aside from that, this is Jason Preston saying, have a good night.
Thank you, and please enjoy Spider-Man Dissembled.